All right, church. We're excited about what God's doing. He's faithful. Yes. He's always on our side. Yes. He's a good God. Yes. All the time. No matter what is right. Hallelujah. All right. If you got your Bibles, we're going to go to places we've been many, many times. Matthew 24, 35. And what I'm going to do is I brought with me tonight the Magnificent Word of the Lord, of course, which is a wonderful scripture book that, again, those of you watching can go online at sandrakennedy.org, and you can order it from us, or we have a Christian bookstore, whatever. But it's a wonderful book that we have put out, and I'm going to use it because it's a scripture book with all kind of wonderful things in it. But I'm going to use it tonight to go to the scriptures that I want to go to, and may throw in some more. So I'm going to do Matthew 25, 35, 1 Peter 1, 25. Don't you worry. I'm just going to read them, a lot of them, okay? And what I'm trying to say to you is it is the Word of God that makes us who we are. It is the Word of God that separates us from the rest of the world. It is the Word of God that lifes us. It is the Word of God that changes us. It is the Word of God who makes us who we are. Yes. It's the power of the Word of Almighty God. And our Bibles is God speaking to us. It's a word from God. Amen. To His people. And because we learned in the Bible about the goodness of God and Jesus being a Savior sent, and that God sent Him to make a way for us for forgiveness and for healing and for deliverance, and God's still in the miracle working business. And it's this Bible that separates us. It's this Bible that makes us who we are. Now, that's the reason I'm going to put some emphasis on the Word, and then we're going to go and I'm going to talk to you about healing, because a lot of you contact us all the time. We have healing explosions here that take place in Augusta. We go across the nation doing healing explosions, and we have a healing center that we have built here that from, I don't know, 16, 17 nations have come. People have come from every single state of the Union have come to be here. We work with the medical profession. All kind of things have happened, and we have seen body parts grow. I'm telling you, God is on your side. Hallelujah. So I'm going to take time in our short time here to point you to the foundation of why we can take such stands that we're taking. So I'm really, if I were to give this a title, I call it Get Desperate About Your Healing. Get Desperate About Your Healing. Now, going over to the Word of the Lord, in 1 Peter 1:25, it says, "The Word of the Lord endures forever." Say forever.
Forever.
Then it says, "Thy word," over in Psalm 119, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." The word enlightens me so that I can understand, removes the darkness from my life, and gives me understanding about what God is doing. It says in Psalm 119, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven." Now, you know, you got to get that forever. Thy word is settling it. There is not anything more powerful than the Word of God. I want you to say it with me. There's nothing more powerful than the Word of God. It is forever settled in heaven, on the earth, under the earth. The Word of the Lord is magnificent, and it reigns supreme. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, it says in Mark 13:31, "Heaven and earth shall pass away," but it says, "My words will not pass away." Now, we're laying a foundation that it's the Word of the Lord. If we call ourselves Christian, it is the Word that sets us apart. It is the Word that lifes us. It is the Word that shows us that Jesus is the one, the only Son of the living God. It is the Word that says we are forgiven. It is the Word that gives us courage. It is the Word that transforms us. It is the Word that heals us. It is the Word that renews us. It is the Word and the Spirit of the Word and the life of the Word. It is the Word that empowers us to walk in abundant life. The power of the Word of God. It is so significant. Then it says in Psalm 107, it says, He sent His word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. And he says over, he says, So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth, Isaiah 55. He says, it shall not return unto me void. This is God saying, I sent my word, I sent it forth, and it will accomplish what I meant for it to do. If I put it out there, it'll do what I, God talking, it will do what I said it will do. Now, in light of that, since I'm talking about getting desperate about your healing, let's go back to three scriptures that we all know real well that have to do with healing. And that, of course, is going over to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53, we have laid the foundation, the importance of the Word of God. So I could put it this way. What is God saying to you about your healing? Are you listening to me? What is God saying about your healing? Because I'm here to tell you, sometimes you and I say opposite of what God says. And that's why we do not see manifestations. That's why we do not see things happen in our life. Because we let our mouth take us down a journey of self-destruction. Now, you know, all of us can fall into traps that come our way. It's hard to keep your head above the water. How many of you know that? Particularly when the devil's just opened all the faucets. It's hard. But what you have to do is you have to rise above. Now, I know what it is to rise above this discouragement. I get discouraged. I've never met anybody who does it. It's how long you stay there. I refuse to sink with the devil. Because I know that if I were really tuned to the Word of God, I could not be discouraged. So when I am discouraged, it means that I have turned inward. It means I have looked at all situations and circumstances. It means I've turned into me and what I think is happening instead of believing that God is big enough for the situation. Now I'm talking to me. And I have to conquer and overcome these things because I'm coming back to the power of the Word. What you believe about the Word lifes you, gives you joy, gives you victory, makes you overcome, gives you a reason to live, and it also gives you a cause. Is there not a cause? And the cause being, this is who God is, this is what God said, shake yourself up. But my question was, what is God saying to you about your healing? What is He saying to you about your healing? Now, God says that He wants me well. Now, all I have to do is spend time in the Bible to find that out. So over in Isaiah, if we were to read it, Isaiah 53, it says, Surely He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem Him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. I'm reading the King James. But He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon Him. And with His stripes we are healed. My question was, what does God say about your sickness? What does God say about your disease? What does God say about your physical condition? What does God say about my infirmities? What does God say about my diseases? What does God think about my position of health? That's the question I'm asking. What does God think about my position? Then somebody says, I don't think I really care what God. Nobody would ever say that, would they? We just act like we don't care. Because God speaks about what He thinks. God was not silent about what He thinks about healing. Anybody listening? Now, whether I walk into in it or not, it's not God's problem. Whether I'm healed or not is not God's problem. Let's settle that. Because this scripture says that, and with His stripes, we are healed. Now, the problem is, I've got to get in agreement with God. Because we don't need to cry out, God, what do you think about this? He says, I know what I think about it. I believe, because remember, God remembers when he put your diseases and my diseases and my hurts and my pains, he remembers when he put them on Jesus. Yes. Now, if you were reading your Bible here and really involved in that particular scripture in Isaiah, you would find out real fast that it says that it is Jesus who put, it's God who put all of these things on Jesus. Anybody remember all that? Yes. In Isaiah 53, it says that surely he is born and that has borne our griefs. That Hebrew word is sicknesses. He's carried our sorrows. That word is pains. You can look it up yourself. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. It was not the Roman soldiers who put sickness and disease on Jesus. The Roman soldiers did not do that. It was God the Father who loved us enough, had to have a perfect sacrifice, a righteous man, and he put all of the sickness, all sickness, read Deuteronomy 28, the last 15 through 60-something, and all of the sicknesses, he laid it on Jesus because he loves you, he loves me. Nobody could bear it but Jesus. Nobody could remove it but Jesus. Nobody could take it but Jesus. Now, my question would be, and let's go over to Matthew. Let's go over to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. Over in Matthew chapter 8, it says, this is talking about Isaiah again. This is really basically quoting again Isaiah. We're going to Matthew 8, 16 and 17. I'm reading the last part of 17 just to save time. He says, himself, talking about Jesus, himself took our infirmities, it says, and bare our sicknesses. So the question would be, if God remembers putting all sickness, all disease, all pain, everything on Jesus and said, he took it and he is the one bearing it, then we should ask ourselves, how come we bearing it? Amen. We're bearing it because we do not believe it's been taken. Right. Let's be honest. Because when the pain hits us, and the doctor gives the disease, and the doctor says this, and the doctor says, the diseases and things come our way because of the world we live in, and the way we live, and what stress and all kind of crazy things do to you, and all the, a disquieted spirit and things like that can absolutely tear us up. We all know that. Proverbs 18:14 says, the spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity. Whether you are at peace inside or not makes all of the difference in the world. So himself took our infirmity. So we got Isaiah saying that we're already healed. We got Matthew quoting Isaiah saying already that Jesus took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. And then I'm going to 1 Peter. 1 Peter 2:24. And you know what it says over there? It says, who his own self bear our sins. Now, let's listen to that. We're saying that Jesus bear our sins, so you know that you don't have to bear your sins. That if you will just accept his forgiveness, walk out from under the guilt and shame, the only way you can do that is to know who you are. And the only way you'll know who you are is know that you have been made righteous. And I have a wonderful book on righteousness of God. Easy to read, easy to understand, but it helps you know what Jesus did for you, that you have been made righteous. Now, if you've been made righteous, my friend, and you know who you are, then you can run to 1 John, and you can run over there, and if you sin, he is faithful and just when you come to him to forgive you. So that in itself says that you and I do not have to bear guilt, shame, condemnation. But you will always bear it, because I'm here to tell you as one who did it, you will always bear it until you really believe that he did for you what he said he did. And if you don't believe it, I'm telling you, you're going to have trouble. It took me years to really believe that God was that good. Are you listening to me? He is so wonderful. He is so magnificent. He is so outstanding. He is not mad with you. He is not against you. He is not punishing you. He is not attacking you. God is on your side. And it took me a long time to believe, and all I had to do was believe the Word of God, and you can find it in Romans real clear and a lot of other places. But anyway, so it says, in his own body on the tree, he took bear our sins, that we being dead to sins, and Romans says you are dead to him. I ain't dead to mine. Well, that's because you've not allowed God to do that for you. Then we should live unto righteousness. Righteousness is the key word here. By whose stripes you were healed. We're not trying to get healed. I asked the question, what does God think about your sicknesses? What does he think about it? And again, your healing. What does he think about it? I know what he thinks about it. He thinks you're healed.
Amen.
He thinks the price has been paid. He remembers what Jesus, but he's waiting on somebody. Remember, the problem is your thinking. Look at your neighbor and say, the problem is your thinking. You are, your emotions are totally controlled by your thinking processes. And I can't help it. I don't care. You're up and down, around, wherever. Your emotions are totally controlled by what you think and where you leave your mind. Unless it's hormones. If you get your mind on the Word of God, I'm here to tell you, and get your mind off of sickness, what a difference life will be. And feelings do not change the Bible. Is anybody listening? Feelings don't change what God says. So that's, I mean, it just doesn't change that. Now, you got to believe, we're back to where we started. You got to believe the Word of God, and then you have to confess, listen closely, you have to confess what God said, and I just read what God said, and you can get a scripture book. Of course, there's no better than ours, hallelujah, and go to our website, sandrakennedy.org, and you can get one. But I'm just saying to you that you can find out what God thinks about it. You can, the Lord will restore your health. That's what it says. He said he will restore it. And he says it won't come up again. I mean, God is a wonderful God. I mean, he just says all kind of things. He says he will make an utter end of it. I mean, he just goes on and on. He says, no, I will not take back one single word I said. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. Now, that doesn't mean you're not ever going to die. That doesn't mean that, because everybody's going to die at some point. But you don't have to die sick. And it says that, I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord. Y'all should have shouted more than that. But so when you come to the Word of the Lord, then no matter the pain, if we're going, I'm asking the question. You have to get desperate about your healing, and then I ask the question: what does Jesus think about your healing? Well, you've got to agree with him. You've got to stand with the Word.
Yes.
You gotta be right there. Whatever Jesus says, you got to agree with him. And no matter the pain, no matter the sickness,
yes,
no matter what's happening,
yes,
you may be sick as a dog,
yes,
but you've got to confess that by the stripes of Jesus, you're healed.
Yes. Yes.
You've got to line up, because what you confess, you will ultimately believe. If you think you have no value and all you do is talk it, you're going to become a wimp and a poor, pitiful person.
Amen.
And it's not anybody doing it to you.
Right.
It is not. Martyrs are a dime a dozen, meaning people who say they are more. Act like, poor, pitiful me, everybody's
right.
doing this to me.
Right.
Real martyrs are hard to come by.
Right.
People who stand up for a cause,
right,
and will go with a cause. But I'm saying to you, start making confessions with your mouth. And then you will possess what you confess.
Amen.
That's what the Bible says. You will confess what you possess. So you have got to side in with the Word of God. Is anybody listening?
Yes.
You have got to, no matter what's happening, no matter what's going on, you have to say, but God.
Amen.
But God. But God's bigger than this. God's working in my body. God's turning this thing around. God's working behind the scenes on my behalf. God is not out of the healing business. He is still the healing. You know, I don't have time to take you there, so just take my word for it or look it up. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, there's a statement there about that we are the garden of God, or we are the field of God. And it talks about one planted, Paul said, I planted, Apollo watered. And it says, and God gave the harvest. God gave the increase. Now the thing that's interesting about that is, how then do you get the word or the seed to come forth? What is the watering? You water it with your mouth. You water it with your mouth. But my point is this. When the seed is planted, tonight for some of you, I am planting seed, meaning you have never heard. The seed is the word of God. You've never heard that God's not mad, that he's still in the healing business, that he's right there. He'll do it for you just like he did it for somebody else. And no, you're not too far gone for God to heal you. For others, I am watering what you have heard. I'm watering that word. I'm watering that word. Now, you have to keep watering it, because the Bible says when the seed is planted, and when it's watered, it is God who will bring the harvest. So you have to water it in order, water it with your mouth. Agreement with God is turning on the water. And you get, Lord, everything about me hurts. Lord, it looks like I'm getting worse. Lord, it looks like everything's about to just fall apart. But God, your word says I'm healed. So I'm calling myself healed. And I am not going to accept that bad report. I am not going to go that word. We're talking about trusting God, not trying God. Amen. We're talking about he's not a man that he should lie. We're talking about believing the word of God. And if need, stand on this word, bless God. Find it. Stand on it. I mean, don't write me a letter, hallelujah. Stand on the word if you need to. I mean, do whatever you need to do, whatever will make a point, whatever will jar you, whatever will bring you to the place to understand there is nothing anywhere, at any place, anytime, no report, no word, nothing that's more important than the word of God. And if you are a child of God, that doesn't make you a servant of God. Israel was the servant. You're the son and daughters of God Almighty. And if God healed the servant, he certainly will heal the son and the daughter. And if he made provision in the Old Testament for a servant, he has definitely in the New Testament, which is his new covenant, he has definitely made a plan for you and I to be healed. Now you got to line up with him. He's on your side. He's made a statement. He's made it known. The stand that he has made, get desperate about your healing and go for it like a bulldog with a bone. Stand on the word and don't you dare move off of it, because God is on your side. Amen, church. Hallelujah.